thanks a lot. Thanking the organizers for this nice meeting and for invitation to here. So I will talk about the project that we are doing in collaboration with the Munich group, Gubenhagen, Ilka Brunner, Max Pinkman, Peter Lust, and Matthias Rauber, who will also be the talk here today later on the show. So the talk is mainly based on these three papers and also includes some yet unpublished material. Here is the main aim of the talk and the outline. So I will very briefly give an introduction to the LNPT. I mean the definition, since here we heard already different definitions, different notations for L infinity, so I will fix the notations that I will use when we talk. And then I will try to explain the idea of this L infinity bootstrap. It is, we mainly care about the consistent deformation of some given gauge field. The idea is that if we can represent the well-defined gauge theory as well as some given deformation as a part of a bigger L-infinity algebra, and then construct this L-infinity algebra, bigger L-infinity algebra, solving the L-infinity relations, then we will get some new deformed, well-defined gauge theory, which in the limit of switching off the deformation will reproduce the initial theory. So this is the idea, and I will try to exemplify this on the example of non-commutative gauge theory with non-constant non-commutativity parameter theta. First, I will construct the sub-algebra, an infinity gauge algebra, which describes the gauge transformations of fields. And for this case, I will also derive the recurrence relations. And I will give some explicit formulas, explicit expressions for this case. I will... I will give the formula for non-commutative, if you like, and non-associative octonionic-like deformations of the abelian gauge transformations in slowly varying field approximation. And then I will also briefly discuss how to derive from this approach the equations of motion, which is not only kinematics, but also the dynamics. So, here is the definition. It was already given, for example, yesterday by all at home. So, an infinity algebra is a graded vector space involved with multilinear maps of a certain degree, which should be graded anti-symmetric and satisfy, in general, an infinite tower of relations, which are known as infinity relations or graded Jacobian. The first three infinity relations are presented here, and essentially means that L1 is a nilpotent derivation, L2 is a bracket, and it should be Leibniz rule of L2 with respect to L1. The third infinity relation, in fact, means that the Jacobi identity with respect to the L2 should satisfied up to L infinity exact terms, which is up to homotopy. And then let us, in principle, all discussed it yesterday, but again, I will discuss now it in more details to fix the notations, how to relate L infinity to gauge transformation. So, let us start with a particular case when we have only space x0, subspace x0, which correspond physically to gauge parameters, and subspace space x minus 1, which corresponds physically to gauge fields. In this case, the graded symmetry of brackets means the following, that bracket is anti-symmetric with respect to the permutations of two elements of the subspace x0, that is two gauge parameters. It is also anti-symmetric with respect to the permutations of two elements of different degrees, degree 0 and degree minus 1, but it should be necessarily symmetric with respect to the permutation of two elements of degree minus 1, that is gauge fields. And since we have only two subspaces here, x0 and x minus 1, in this case, we have only two types of non-trivial brackets. The bracket with one gauge parameter and n fields, and the bracket with two gauge parameters and n fields. And these brackets should satisfy the following Jacobi identities with two and three gauge parameters correspondingly. So once we have these brackets and which satisfy this Jacobi identity, we may construct the following. We may define the gauge transformation, gauge variation like this, and then we may check that once we defined the gauge variations like this, we have this closure condition, meaning that the commutator of two gauge transformations is again a gauge transformation, however, in general, with field-dependent gauge parameter here. And here is the expression for this C bracket here. So the bracket with one gauge parameter and n gauge field enter to the definition of the gauge transformation, while the brackets with two gauge parameters and n fields enter to the closure condition here. And due to the Jacobi identities, we may see that the generalized Jacobi identity for the gauge transformation holds true in this case. However, also what is remarkable about the L infinity is that having this construction, we may take into account not only kinematics, that is gauge transformations of fields, but also the dynamics. So in this case, we should add additional space, x minus 2, which include the equations of motion. And once we suppose that x minus 2 is not empty, it means that the following brackets also can be non-zero, and they should satisfy following non-trivial Jacobi identity. And then from these brackets here, we may form the equation of motion, which is covariant under gauge transformation like this. So this is more or less the general setup, in some sense, all of yesterday talk about this. And now I will try to formulate our idea, our approach. So, in general, as I said, we may have an infinite number of these brackets which define the gauge transformations and equations of motion. But they are not arbitrary, they should satisfy Jacobi identities. And if we can take some well-defined gauge theory, and some deformation and represent these two elements as a part of some bigger L infinity structure, then in principle solving, as I said, step by step these higher Jacobi identities, that is constructing higher and higher brackets, we may construct this new gauge theory, which in the limit of switching off the deformation will reproduce your original gauge theory. So this is the idea. And now let me start doing this in case of non-commutative gauge theories with coordinate dependent non-commutativity parameter here, because we exactly explicitly consider this situation. What is the problem with gauge theories on coordinate dependent non-commutative space? The problem is that in general the Leibniz rule here is violated. That is why if we just take the normal action for gauge theory and just substitute all pointwise products with the start products, then this theory will not longer be gauge invariant because of a violation of the Leibniz rule. So we should take care of this situation somehow. And there were some previous approaches, quite interesting approaches, to solve this problem of Leibniz rule. One of them is Hopf algebra approach, and it is based on deformed coproduct and deformed Leibniz rule. But to do so, you need a specific element, which is called twist. And this element is known just for very few, very specific, very exotic examples like kappa quant correct. But in general case, it is not known. So in principle, in general, we cannot use this approach. There is another approach proposed by a group of Wes, Schub, Madora. Covariant coordinate approach, that is, you may, instead of using normal derivative, you can use similar derivative, that is, star commutator with x. However, here, at least, naive commutative limit is not clear, because in this case, when you consider commutative limit, this derivative vanishes, and so what will happen with the dynamics? And we
how about the Dossett approach? It's more or less, it looks like that it should really avoid the zipper because it is in the fibers.
Well, I'm not aware of
all the benefits. Okay, it's essentially unfolding of this story.
Okay. So, we propose this infinity approach, and how we do it is the following. So, as I said, as initial setup, first we let us work with gauge theory. So we state that our initial bracket L1 is just a derivative. Since for a while we are working only with this sub-algebra L infinity gauge, so X2 is empty, and that is why L1 from A for a while is just zero. And then we impose our deformation stating that the bracket L2 is a star commutator. That is, in the leading order, this is just a Poisson bracket plus higher contributions from theta. And then, as I said, we should solve L infinity relations in order to construct these brackets. Here in particular, it should be emphasized that L2 from one element from x0 and another element from x minus 1 is different in general from L2 calculated on two elements from x0. So to find this bracket here, we need to solve this identity, and this is can be written in this form. And one may obviously see that this is the solution to this Jacobi identity here. However, also we may say that this solution is not unique. For example, we may take this solution here and add arbitrary symmetric part here. Because of the symmetry here, the solution also will satisfy this equation. However, as we showed that, quite recently, this ambiguity here can be in a certain sense gauged away by L-infinity quasi-isomorphism, which physically is equivalent to the Zagreb-Witten map, that is field definition. And Matthias today will discuss in more details what is happening here. Then we may proceed, and for this we need to solve higher infinity relations and to construct higher brackets. So next, the copy identity is the one with three gauge parameters, and it can be written here. On the first line, we see just a Jacobian. So if we work with the associative star product, then Jacobian vanishes, and in this case, we can just set this bracket as 3 from one field and two gauge parameters just to be 0. But in general, we may consider also non-associative deformations, and in this case, we need non-vanishing bracket F3 from two gauge parameters and one field. And then, so here is the crucial point of our construction, because in the beginning I stated that in principle I pretend to construct a recurrence relation for the derivation of L infinity gauge algebra. So here is the following. To define the bracket L3 from one gauge parameter and two field, which enters the definition of a gauge transformation, I need to solve this L infinity relation, which depends on two gauge parameters and one gauge field here, explicitly written here. This we may rewrite in this form. The left-hand side of this equation is undetermined, while the right-hand side was already determined. It is written here in terms of previously defined brackets. And now what is important is that due to the graded symmetries of this bracket, for example, this bracket should be symmetric with respect to permutation of these two elements. They are from space x minus 1. So we may see that the sum of cyclic permutations of the left-hand side gives identically 0. It means that here we have non-trivial consistency condition on the right-hand side, which was determined previously. And so this condition here, the cyclicity condition on the right-hand side. When we just started doing this, so we calculated explicitly this expression, and we saw that, okay, it does satisfy, and for us it was a kind of miracle. But now we see actually that this is not a miracle, this is just a consequence of the infinity construction, because as I will show on the next slide, this consistency condition, this cyclicity relation just follows from the previously satisfied Jacobian identity. Indeed, we may take this definition of the right-hand side and substitute it here, and we will have this expression here. And now, using the Jacobian identity with two gauge parameters, we may take L1 here out of the bracket L2 and thus represent it in this form here, which is nothing but the L1 from the Jacobian identity previously satisfied, Jacobian identity from three gauge parameters here. So that is why the consistency condition is satisfied as a consequence of the previously satisfied Jacobian identities. And now, using this, that it is 0, we may just take and construct the bracket we were looking for in this form here, just by symmetrization of the right-hand side of the equation.
Do you use some sort of homology statement for L1? Because that's what typically you do when you do this perturbation theory. Do you know the homology of L1?
No, here I do not use this explicitly.
And it has right graded symmetry because it is a symmetrization, and also because of this consistency condition, we may really check that this expression here does satisfy this equation here. So now we may take the explicit expressions and already write this answer. So in principle, the answer for this bracket is quite involved, but as I said, it was obtained in quite, well, simple way. Here it makes sense to make the following observations. As I said, the consistency condition for the solution of this equation, graded simplicity, holds true as just a consequence of an infinity structure. And the second, even in the associative case, we need a higher bracket, namely this bracket, in order to compensate the violation of the Leibniz rule here. And in principle, we may continue with this construction in higher relations. But before that, I will also discuss in more details the situation in non-associative case, how to solve this Jacobi identity here. Because, well, when the bracket is associative, here we have the following. The right-hand side, it is written in terms of bracket L3 depending on 2 gauge parameters and 1 gauge field. So I said in associative case it vanishes. So in associative case we these kind of Jacobi identities are satisfied automatically. But in non-associative case we need to solve it, and we have the same more or less situation. That is, we have left hand side which is yet undetermined, and we have right hand side. And because of a graded symmetry of this object, we have this consistency condition, the graded cyclicity for right-hand sides. And again, we may check that indeed this condition holds true as a consequence of the previous Jacobi identities, and again, we may take the solution just as corresponding symmetrization, and we have this expression here. So, in general, in order to construct, in order to define the brackets Ln depending on 1 gauge parameter and n gauge fields, we need to solve these kind of L infinity relations, which can be represented in this form. Left hand side is unknown, right hand side is known. Because of the graded cyclicity, we have this consistency relation, which we may prove by the induction that holds true as a consequence of the previously satisfied Jacobi identities. And then the solution is just constructed as a symmetrization of the right hand side here. This is for the bracket, which, as I said, depends on 1 gauge parameter and n gauge fields. For the bracket which depends on 2 gauge parameters and n gauge fields, we do more or less the same procedure, but following the equation I showed before. So this is more or less the general consideration. Now, if we want to calculate something explicit, well, it is better to make some assumptions in order to simplify our consideration. So let us take the approximation of slowly varying fields. That is, the field should not be necessarily small, but it's slowly varying. So we take into account only the first derivatives of the fields. So in this case, the star commutator can be approximated just as a Poisson bracket. And here we have explicit expression for this bracket L2 that I wrote before. And for some particular cases of Poisson bracket here, for example, for SU2-like Poisson structure, we may calculate using the procedure I described before these higher brackets order by order, and we may see, we may find this nice structure here. And then already from the closure condition here, we may fix this function here, and it is written in this form here. So this is the non-commutative as utilized deformation of the abelian gauge transformations in the slowly varying field approximation. So using this procedure of L1-infinity bootstrap. Any questions so far? Okay. And now we can, in principle, continue and also do more or less the same in case of also non-associative deformation. So, if we could do it with SU2-like Poisson structure, we may ask also what is happening in the case of octonionic-like structure. I can consider here the quasi-Poisson structure is amorphic to the commutator algebra of octonions. Here, eta ADC is totally antisymmetric tensor of rank 3 in 7 dimensions, so it is defined here. And the Jacobi identity here is violated, so the Jacobiator is given here, and here eta ABCD is totally antisymmetric tensor of rank 4 in 7 dimensions. So because of the violation of associativity here, we have that these kind of brackets, n plus 2 from 2 gauge parameters and n fields will be non-zero. So it means that closure condition here also will change. So the commutator of 2 gauge transformations in general will be again a gauge transformation, but with field-dependent gauge parameter here. And again, here we can do explicit calculations, and we can calculate this C bracket here, and it is given in this form. Just to check whether we have the correct expression or not, we may consider the restriction of on three-dimensional subspace here. So, for example,
sorry, I missed where the octonionic algebra enters the gauge transformation.
In gauge transformations, it is entered here.
Okay.
And so, when we restrict ourselves on three-dimensional subspace and not with a C2 structure, we have the following. In three dimensions, any totally antisymmetric tensor of rank 4 vanishes. So all this part vanishes, and here this bracket just becomes a bracket written in the previous slide. So here is non-associative octonionic-like deformation of the abelian gauge transformation in slowly varying field approximation. Why this is can be at least potentially interesting for physics? Because this paper here was shown that this octonionic algebra, quasi-Poisson structure related to the imaginary octonions by this linear transformation can be related to the following structure, which describe the R flux in M theory, non-geometric R flux in M theory. And here we may also see that lambda here is understood to be the M theory value. So when we consider contraction of this algebra, lambda goes to zero. So here the both right sides vanishes, meaning that x4 becomes the central element. Here also this guy vanishes. And here we have the non-vanishing part, and this is exactly the constant R flux in string theory. So from this expression here, we may derive this deformation of the abelian gauge transformation on the non-geometric R flux backgrounds. So this is all what I wanted to say about the gauge transformations, that is about the kinematics. But also, as I said, in principle, the nice thing about infinity, that also it takes into account the dynamics. So here, now we may ask also, what if we add this additional subspace, which includes the equations of motion? And when we do this, it means that we will have non-vanishing bracket L1 from A, which is given like this. I'm considering the particular example of the formation of abelian Jevons simons. So that is why I choose L1 in this form here. And as I showed before in the previous slides, to construct the equation of motion, we will have to solve infinity relations. And so do we need order by order, we may find this expression. So here, for a while, I don't have this expression in all orders. Because, well, the expression is quite involved. We were able to do it for L1 from A, L2 from AA, and L3 from AAA, and it is written here. But possibly, well, solving it for higher brackets, we possibly will be able to recognize some structure, and then using this construction to fix the explicit expression. And what is also important here, that you may see that these equations of motion are highly nonlinear, so they carry also a kind of self-interaction terms because of the non-commutativity. And so this is what we have done so far, and the conclusion is the following. So in principle, using this mathematical framework of the infinity, we may construct, as I said, consistent deformation of some given well-defined gauge theory. And we did it in case of non-commutativity, that is constructing the non-commutative gauge theories with non-commutative gauge parameter theta in such a way that when you switch off the non-commutativity, you recover explicitly the initial gauge theory. I gave an example of Jevons-Simons. For young males, you should take this L1, and in our paper also there are some calculations for non-commutative young males. But obviously, this is not the end of the story, so we are still discussing, we are still working on this approach, and there are a lot of open questions, like, as I said, it would be nice to have explicit expression for the equations of motion here in order to try to understand the physics which may stay beyond of all this, and in order to understand the possible physical consequences of this theory. So that's it. Thanks.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Your non-commutative theory you construct, is it, can it be considered as a deformation, for instance, of Young-Mills or Chern-Simons in the sense of these consistent deformations of gauge theories about varnishing? So is it like a deformation so that
vanishing deformation parameter, you have just the Young means, and for what typically is formal, and then if you have a formal deformation wave, you go to the non-commutative one. And it is still a consistent gauge theory.
Well, I believe yes, but I'm not very aware about this specific construction of
No, it's not about construction, it's just, it's like a family starting from Young means and preserving the symmetry for any value of non-commutativity parameter.
In that case, the non-commutativity can be observed arbitrary or not?
Well, if you succeed, make a consistent deformation.
Yeah, no, but in this case, at least what I showed that that at least in this formalism, some calculations can be well more or less easily done, and you have this expression in particular. So I don't know whether it's possible to do so.
So it gives a new gauge theory, right?
Yes,
so you start with Young means and you get non-commutative Young means.
Yes, and it gives a new gauge structure. Yes.
But its gauge structure is again equivalent to the Young means gauge structure, through sort of Zeidler-Witten model.
Sort of, yes.
Because it was proved that, for instance, if the gauge group is semi-simpler, so that some cohomology vanishes, then gauge structure is rigid for Young means of Chern. For Chern samples, if I remember correctly, you can't even get any deformation. Whatever you do, it will be equivalent gauge theory. But for Young means, you can't deform gauge structure, but you can deform Lagrangian. So it's a new gauge theory, but the deformation of gauge structure is just rigid.
But also, what is important here, the proper gauge group is not conserved, it is also deformed. Because you start, for example, with the abelian gauge group, you have just here commutated, so and here you have something else, so it is different.
But then you can get to Young means from abelian.
Well,
I see.
Probably a related question that in the Chern-Simons case. If you solve the equations, so is it a pure gauge, the solution of your theory?
A pure gauge?
In the usual Chern-Simons theory, the solution of the equations of motion is a pure gauge, so the field is non-dynamical. Does it remain the same in your deformed case?
Well, this I don't know yet, because for this, as I said, it would be nice to have the complete form for the equation.
But you can solve them order by order.
And this is what I'm trying to do now, but I did not finish.
Okay.
Any other questions? No. Thank you very much again.